Hey guys, welcome back. So now with getting into Dark Knight's death metal, Doom Metal, Part 3, like it's within this series that we follow the team that's going for Perpetua's throne. And with them making their way to unlock this achievement, like, it ain't looking good. So let's get into it. But first, if you're new to the channel, be sure to subscribe to catch the spills every week. And don't forget to hit that bell up top so we can squat up in the comments for the first hour. Alright, so getting into Doom Metal Part 3, like so far, this team has been split up into two parts, because in the case of Martian Manhunter, we've previously seen why he had left the rest of the team, which obviously was a bad call, because had he stayed with them, they probably wouldn't be in the situation of the Valley of Starros. But since they are, everyone with the exception of Lex Luthor and Nightwing, like everyone else is still stuck within their illusions, but on the outside, they're being navigated under these Starros' mind control, and with that, they're either getting lured in to be eaten, or influence to attack Nightwing and Lex. But here's the thing, because in the case of Martian Manhunter, with him going against Mindhunter, which at this point the fight is more so shifted to the background, with part 1 being the reveal of Mindhunter guarding Perpetua's throne, part 2 being like your first round between Mindhunter and Manhunter, but it's here in part 3 where Williamson kinda asks us the question, did Mindhunter get what he wanted from John, which essentially is like the secrets to the hero's plans, which in this case isn't so much a threat to the grand scope of Wonder Woman's plan, but instead it's more so a factor of life and death to John's team who is out here making their way to the throne. Alright, so check this out, like the first thing I gotta say, like as we go into part 3, like one of the first things on my mind, and it was the same thing that was on my mind when we finished part 2, but like one of the first things I was thinking was like, okay, like this whole time in part 3, we're gonna be in the Valley of Starros, like the whole time, and at the end everybody wakes up. Well, gladly, that's not the case. But as it turns out, like with Nightwing and Luthor being the two who aren't under the influence of the Starros, like for starters, we quickly get an explanation to why they're not. Because in the case of Nightwing, and we kind of touched on his reason in the last video, but like in his case, when these Starros started showing him what they believed that he wanted to see, like when he rejected it, then he started to snap out of it. But Nightwing also had an advantage in this instance, because his memories, though they're restored at this point, it's still early on and they're still in a state of fragmentation, which could also lean into the extra partitions which we've seen in the Nightwing series. But while they're ducking and dodging everybody else, like Lex Luthor just throws out this idea. But in the case of Luthor, he mentions where years ago he had experimented with Starros, and with doing so over the course of time he had built a resistance. But it's also here where Lex realizes that these Starros are multiple sizes, which then lends to the possibility of some of them even being microscopic, and because of that, Lex gets an idea. He gets Nightwing's help to hotwire Cyborg, and with doing so he gets Cyborg to kind of burn the rest of them out of the air, because prior to that they had still been breathing a number of them in. And when he does this, like it works as far as getting everyone to come to their senses, but then they have another problem when they realize that underneath the entire valley there is a much bigger Starro. And it's like really and truly at this point, like none of these guys are equipped to handle this. And because of that, they make the sensible decision and they run. But then it's also here, like in the middle of the chaos of trying to get out of there, that like for a second they notice that Detective Chimp is missing. And quickly Nightwing finds him and he scoops him up, and with doing so he also realizes that Detective Chimp hasn't fully snapped out of their influence, because even now he's still having visions of Nightmaster, who we'd seen killed back in Dark Knight's Metal, but he's still dealing with the effects because he wasn't within the radius where Lex had Cyborg clear the air. But as they're running away, Lex leads them to his ship, which yet again is one of his many resources that he's accumulated during the time that he's been on Earth since the Darkest Night or the Batman Who Laughs had changed things up. And eventually they get on the ship with him, but for a little bit they're a bit hesitant about following Lex, but Nightwing tells him like, look, we might as well, because last time we tried it ourselves, it didn't exactly play out too well. But then it's also here where we get a bit of this conversation between Detective Chimp and Cyborg, and man, it is heavy. Because starting with Detective Chimp, he just starts off saying like he's done having friends, everyone he knows has either been hurt or killed in some of the worst ways imaginable, and that collectively they gotten so desperate that they teamed up with Lex Luthor to save the Legion of Doom. And because of that, he feels like their days of being heroes is like they're done, like this is it, like we're not coming back from this one. And Cyborg tries to give him a bit of encouragement, and he's like, look, we've made a number of comebacks, but nothing stops the Justice League. But Detective Chimp then tells him something that's been reoccurring throughout Doom Metal, and for the most part from Nightwing, but it's been said a lot, because it's here where Detective Chimp, he tells Cyborg, we're not the Justice League, we're the Suicide Squad. And when he said that, it kind of hit me because it makes sense. Because out of all the different teams of heroes who have went their separate ways for their separate missions, like collectively, like each and every last one of these guys is a Suicide Squad. Because the missions that they all been going on throughout Death Metal, like they've been missions like you're probably gonna die. And I mean, even still, Batman said don't die, but even still, at this point, we all kind of know where this is heading. But as they make their way, Starfire makes the point of, okay, we're not the Justice League, but even still, we gotta do everything we can to help the Justice League. And if that means a fight to the death, then we'll just have to go down fighting. But then after that, like when they ask Lex like where we're heading to, or like what's the next move, but just because he has to at least subtly hit you with that I told you so in a like sly type of way, he's like, due to your reckless endeavors, we're behind schedule. And when he says that, I'm just like, look, Lex, mother, I ain't ask you all that. Like, we just want to know what's up ahead. Like, what are we getting into next? But with doing this, he also tells them about a few of the things that they'll run into on their way to Brimstone Bay. But then he also lets them know, like, when they get there, he's killing Perpetua. And like, when Lex says that, like, I get it. Like, he wants his revenge back from Hell Arisen. But then again, at the same time, I'm thinking like, well, how does that exactly work? Because I mean, we know that Perpetua is powered down, and depending on how weak she is now, she's likely an easier target, with Owlman and the Lanterns cutting her off in Multiverse's End. But also, and I could be just thinking too deep about this, but here's the thing, like just off of the fact that Perpetua is connected to the multiverse, which can be broken down and built up over and over again, but ultimately, if the multiverse dies, Perpetua dies, which is why Perpetua wanted the multiverse to live on forever in the first place. But with that in mind, it has me also thinking of the opposite. Like, if Perpetua is killed, like actually killed, like wouldn't that destroy the multiverse as well? Because it's very possible that that's a two-way street. And I mean, that still may very well be the solution. It might be the way they usher in 5G, who knows? But when they make their way to Brimstone Bay, Kendra feels the urgency through John's connection that she needs to get to him quickly. But Lex is like, no, we need to handle this with stealth. Because really, if they get caught and even still have to go up against the Omega Titan or even Mindhunter, like this could cost them critical time and Perpetua's throne may move again. But of course, Kendra's not trying to hear that. She swings on Lex and she just takes off, making her way up to one of the hilltops to where she finds John, who's there alone and barely able to stand. And at this point, Lex and the others, they go their way to towards the throne, and Detective Chimp, like, he doesn't even leave the boat, and he's like, you know what, I think I'm gonna die in the car, and like, y'all go ahead, I'm good, like, I just rather watch y'all walk into sudden death. And surely enough, like, as soon as they go out there, they are spotted by the Omega Knight, and Lex is like, this is it, we're donezo, we're doomed. But then also, when this happens up on the hilltop with Kendra, she then realizes that she's not up there with John, but instead she's up there with Mindhunter, who had posed as John to lure her out. And as it turns out, prior to this point, he had succeeded at going through John and getting to her, because the connection between John and Kendra was closer than anyone else's. But also, when this happens, like going back to Lex and the others, like as they're standing right in front of the Omega Knight, like right in the nick of time, like while they're out there, right in the nick of time. And now I'm just playing, nothing happens in the nick of time, like they all get blasted. And Mindhunter tells Kendra, because you are first and foremost in John's thoughts, you have to watch everyone die. But so now, even with this happening, and it ends here, but even with this happening, I gotta say that I don't fully believe this, because to me, I truly believe, like, from the moment that they arrived at Brimstone Bay and Kendra like felt John's connection, like reaching out to her, that it was really like from this point forward, like everything that we had seen up to the Omega Knight, like everything from that point forward, it had been an illusion that was imposed by Mindhunter. And that's just my thoughts, like we'll really find out in part 4, but for right now, like that's what I think really happened, and I'm sticking to it. And let me know what you guys think, like down in the comments below. And so now, real quick before we go, I want to give a special shout out to all the Patreons. Thank you guys for all your support. And for anyone who's new here and you want more information on how to support the channel, I got a link below to where you can go to patreon.com/dopespill. But that'll do it for this one, guys. Let me know your thoughts down in the comments below. And I'm curious to know like what you guys think about the whole Lex Luthor killing Perpetua idea and the effect that that might have on the multiverse. But on top of that, also let me know what you guys think about Mindhunter, because he did gain access to Kendra's mind, which I believe is just the start of a three-way battle between Mindhunter, Kendra, and John. And that is a mind battle that I'll sit through. Like, that's different. I can sit through that. But let me know your thoughts down in the comments below, and we'll do it again in the next one. All right, later.